I was wondering if it's a bad sign that when the statistician is coming up to talk, I see a long line for talk. Hopefully it isn't. I hope y'all are doing really well this morning. And during this talk, I would like it if you feel free to ask questions during it. I'm probably going to ask you some questions because that's kind of fun for me to see if you're watching. And as I noticed towards the end of the week, everyone starts moving towards the back of the room. Then I really start looking at people back to the room. But anyhow, so we're going to, today, right now, we're going to talk about multiplicity, multiple testing, and clinical trials. And I think the title, it's a much clever title in the agenda, multiplicity, incentives, and the risks of fooling oneself. And this actually ties in perfectly with the discussion we just had of biomarkers. And in fact, the question also that we just had about exploring for biomarkers, looking, not using the term negatively, but data searching, kind of fishing, looking around. It's a very common issue, and it's something you're going to have to deal with somewhere along the way. It doesn't mean it's a bad thing, but it's just something you need to recognize. Okay, financial disclosures on an employee, if you're a consultant. We have multiple clients, and I guess I already disclosed I am a biostatistician, so I like to think we're friendly folk. So what's the concern with multiplicity? Multiplicity is multiple comparison. The concerns come when you perform numerous statistical tests. You do a lot of tests. Some of these may be real, or may be a true effect, or may be something that's going on. But some may be significant due to chance alone. And you've heard in many of the talks, and it's just because going on, about type 1 error, the probability, in simplistic terms, the probability of making an incorrect conclusion that there's an effect. And we've talked about p-values, which is the probability of observing the result or a more extreme result under the null hypothesis. And we talked about this in the framework of hypothesis testing, where we had the null hypothesis being a situation where the thing we wanted to reject, there wasn't a difference between treatments, or that your treatment, your active treatment interest wasn't bigger than the other. So it's the probability of observing the result that you saw under that hypothesis. So therefore, you want your p-value to be small, so showing that you do have a true effect. So the more statistical tests you do, the more chance you have of making this type 1 error, this false conclusion. The more shots you take at a basket with a half-court shot, the more chance you have of making a half-court shot. The more hockey, playing hockey, the more shots you take on goal, the more chance you have of making that goal. So did anyone see on box that I did send a background reading through? Did anyone read it? That's okay. it's a nice reading that I like. It's a paper by Don Berridge in 2012, Multiplicities in Cancer Research, Ubiquitous and Necessary Evils. It's from JNCI, and so although it's in a cancer journal, please don't, this applies across all sorts of research. I really like the paper because it starts by saying you're traveling in a foreign land and you run across the town of Oz. And if you see that kind of paper, that sucks me in right away, and I'm like, this has to be interesting somehow. They're talking about Oz. So, but I really like the, and it's not just because the author's name is Barry, I really like the examples in the paper, and I really like the strategy at the end. Because multiplicity is very complicated, and there's many different opinions on how you should handle it and if you should handle it. And so, like I said, I really like the strategy at the end, and so I recommend when you go back home, it's a good reference to keep in mind, and it's a good thing to follow as you move through your trials. Okay, multiplicities. How much of a concern do you think multiplicities are? A lot? A little? A lot. See, I'm going to ask you questions a lot. Why do you think a lot? I like follow-up questions. No, just why do you think it's a...
In my field, pretty awful defenses and settings.
Okay. Very good example. We'll go through that. So in your field, you have multiple things you're looking at. It's just the nature of your field that there are multiple outcomes to look at. And so you have to account for these multiple tests you may do. The amount of concern you have with the multiplicities always depends on your research goal. And the goal of your project depends on how much risk you're willing to take to make these false conclusions, these type 1 errors. We've talked a lot about this throughout the week in study design, just clinical trials in general. I'm sure in your small groups, everything we talk about ties back to your research question. You spend a lot of time on what your research question, what your objectives are. Same thing here with multiplicity, tying it back to your research question. So for an example, phase 3 confirmatory trial. This is kind of an end-all, be-all, final step. You're looking at this treatment effect. You want, you're hoping that you see the difference. You're hoping it would go through a regulatory process, it would get approved, it would become a standard of care. You want a very, very high level of evidence there. You're going to have a small chance that you want to conclude that something's real when it's not. So this is a high level of evidence, so here you would want a more stringent control type 1 error. However, in the exploratory study, you're still learning, you might be hypothesis generating, you're in the learn phase, you may want less stringent control. You may desire less stringent control, and that's fine, because you may be more willing to take a type 1 error because you're looking for different things, you're looking for potential. You don't have to have the same level of evidence as in a phase 3 confirmatory trial. So in this situation, there's not this alpha level, this level of false positive, it's not an end-all be-all that has to be 5%. You need to think about it in the context of your question. I've seen alphas of 10%. I've seen alphas of type 1 error rates willing to accept of 20%. As Erica said in her talk, you may be willing to take that higher because you're really looking for something in the hopes of finding something, maybe more willing to investigate further something that has the chance of making that false positive. So again, the type 1 error levels need to be set in the context of your study question. But the other important part, and we've been talking about this all week too, is think about what's next. What's the next step in your process? Don't just think slowly in the box of what you're doing now. Think about looking ahead. What are the next steps? You're likely going to have a lot of you, most of you, I'm guessing, are in more of the exploratory phase with your project still, right? Is everyone in the exploratory phase? Okay, good. Anyone more confirmatory? No, so you're still in the learn phase. So you're thinking about what's going to be my next step. I'm going to take what I do here, and I'm going to do something next with it. And in that next step, I may be looking more to confirm it and have a more stringent control. But here I'm still really trying to learn. There's a lot I don't know. So multiplicities are a consequence of collecting lots of data. How many people here have participated as an investigator in a multi-center large phase 3 clinical trial? Okay. With those, how many ECRF forms have you seen that come through with that trial? There's a lot. A lot of things are collected. Have you ever seen the data come through for these trials? The data sets? Okay. So there's a lot that comes through. You've got a lot of data. You've got all this sitting in front of you. You want to look at it. You want to learn. You want to go through it. There's lots of things you want to look at. Multiplicities are a definite concern, but it's natural because you can collect all this information. So you go through all this work. You've gone through the week here, you created a really nice protocol, you submit your grant, you get it funded, and you're very excited, and you're going through and you've done all this work in those projects. You definitely want to get your money's worth, your effort's worth. You want to get make sure the participants in the study get their effort worth. You want to look at everything possible in your head. You think you want to look at everything possible and really find out what's going on. You don't want to waste the possibility of gathering information. So you're going to collect a lot of information. It's easy to do with the computing resources. We can store the data. We can analyze it. We can manipulate it. There's nothing holding it back that way. We've got the ECRS, so we don't have tons of paper floating around. So it's very easy to do. And so it becomes very, very tempting when you have this large, large set of data in front of you to start diving in and looking for something. And that's not a bad thing. You just need to be careful about how you do it. I'll give you some strategies. The big thing is when you're done, you've got all this work, you've put all this time ahead of time, you want your results to be credible so that the readers when you publish them believe it. And the big thing is you want it to be reproducible. If someone goes out and conducts a similar study, you would hope that they would get something similar and not get something completely opposite. And so you don't want your research to be completely discredited. So reproducible research is obviously a big deal. So you need to think about multiplicities in this context. So what you put out there can be reproduced, but also that the reader can read it and have confidence in it, feel it's credible, maybe accept it into clinical practice. Okay, so I'm going to go through a bunch of different examples now. And I'm not going to get real statistical about statistical methods to account for multiplicities. I'm just going to give a lot of real-life examples that I've experienced as a collaborator with clinicians. And thinking about these examples, I break them down into three categories. We've got multiple tests across multiple treatment arms in a trial. We've got multiple tests among subgroups. And we've got multiple tests performed while data is accumulated. In your projects right now, how many people have multiple treatment arms in their study? Okay, great. How many are going to have subgroups? No one's going to have subgroups. You will have subgroups. You may not think you have them now, but you will have subgroups. I assure you that, or you will have the temptation to have subgroups, let me say that.
I've got stratification.
A little bit of stratification, looking in different strata, yeah. How many are going to have multiple tests performed while the data is accumulating, maybe interim analyses? All right, good. Okay, so we'll go through each of these examples. But you can see that the most common one was the multiple treatment arms, which is where you're at right now. And that's very, very common in the learn phase, and a very good thing because you're probably still deciding, comparing between different interventions, looking at different doses. And that's a good thing to have right now because you may not know the best dose to take forward. So let's talk about an example. So let's say we have a randomized trial, and we have four active doses of a new drug, and we're comparing it to a control or placebo arm. So you think, okay, I've got these four active doses, so I want to compare each one of these to placebo to see what works. And therefore, it's resulting in four statistical tests. And let's say that the doses are ordered as far as magnitude, and I'm just throwing a completely hypothetical example here that maybe they're 1, 2, 3, 4 milligrams dose. So you go through, you do your analyses, you compare them to placebo, you do the tests, and you find p-values across these doses in the order of 0.2, 0.18, 0.04, and 0.3. So of those p-values, what's the first thing that you notice in that sequence? What catches your eye first? Of course, the 0.04, because you're looking at that, you're commonly thinking, oh, I want a p-value less than 0.05, I see that 0.04. So the 0.04 comes on the third dose. Thinking about that, do you believe that dose 3 is the only effective dose here? Why not?
Because it might be just by chance.
It might be just by chance. Do you think others are going to believe that you take these results and put it out in the literature? You did these results, you publish it. Do you think others are going to believe that you have something going on with this drug? There may be questions. It's not totally clear. Looking at this, if I was looking at this presented this way in a paper, I may be like, well, this is kind of weird. The 3 milligram dose was the one that was significant. I need to actually go back and think in the context of the question in the background. What was my question, and what was my study designed to answer? So I started with these four doses, and I was looking at increasing levels of the dose. Looking at increasing the level of the doses, I was thinking maybe naturally that giving more drug would have more of an effect. I might see more of an outcome that went up with a higher dose. You may have other thoughts where you might have thought of it in a U-shaped or something like that, but in this case, I'm thinking, okay, I'm gonna go increasing dose. As you get higher, I'm thinking you might see more effect, or I might see an effect as I get higher. So looking and seeing that the third dose had a relationship, but the fourth dose did not, makes me question it. And also, thinking back, simply comparing each dose to the control really wasn't my question. My question was thinking that there was going to be a dose response across the doses. So my point here is don't blindly live by p-values when thinking of statistical tests. Think about your question. In this case, what I would have done is, number one, I would have thought about this issue very closely when I was designing the study and writing the protocol. So I would think about how I was going to make decisions ahead of time as far as picking my winner, maybe I was picking a couple of winning doses, how I was going to do this. Think about before I even started getting data, before I even started looking at it. And I would have pre-specified in the protocol with the design what my goal was, and in this case it was to pick the best dose. Let's say it was to pick the best dose. I would have pre-specified how I was going to pick that dose. Is it the dose with the best effect? If I end up seeing multiple doses at work, how am I going to pick from them? Am I going to pick one? Am I going to pick two? What's my next step going forward? thinking about all these ahead of time is really going to help you refine your question and help have situations where you can account for this potential for multiplicities. If I didn't think ahead, I just blindly went and said, hey, comparison one to placebo, that really didn't answer my question. So what I would have liked to have done here is I would have actually liked to put a statistical model that modeled the dose response and use that with the pre-specified criteria as far as how I would select my best dose. I probably would have liked to select two doses if two doses met the decision criteria to carry forward to another trial to show in a confirmatory sense that it actually did have an effect. Okay, any questions on that example? I like to break things up and make sure y'all keep listening. All right, we'll go to multiple subgroups. And I say you may not have subgroups now, but you're going to be very tempted later to have subgroups. So again, let's say we have a randomized trial, because I love randomized trials, and we're comparing intervention A to the standard of care. We did all this work at the end of the trial. I was really excited going at the end of the trial. I didn't see a result. Very disappointed. But we have all this data. I know there's something going on here. I know this drug works. I had the rationale going in. I had done pilot studies. I had all this background going in. I know there has to be something here, and I've got all this data in front of me. It's very, very tempting to go start diving into the data, piecing it apart, looking at different combinations of the variables, and seeing, well, maybe there was some group in here what worked better than it did. Very natural curiosity. Not saying that you shouldn't do this. What I'm saying is you need to be very careful how you do this and how you report it. So in this situation, I've got all this data. I started going in. I looked at outcomes. I said, okay, what if they're male? What if they're older, maybe greater than 50 years of age? Kind of split them into an older, younger population. And I looked at those within pre-existing disease acts. So I put it into this three combination bucket. And I get in there. I've got to this point, and I see a benefit with intervention A. So you as a reader, do you believe that this is a real result? That they're actually, that the drug actually works here? It might, but it's kind of looking at this maybe contrived combination of a subgroup. It may not make sense, and it would make me as a reader question. So another way to step back and think of it is, if I were to design a trial overall saying, okay, I'm only going to enroll men, I'm only going to enroll men at the older than 50, and I'm only going to allow those in with pre-existing disease acts, if I were to design my trial that way, do you think you would have won? And so if you step back and think, if I would have started in this population, I'm not sure. But you got the significant p-value, very, very tempting, and you're thinking, hey, the journal's going to like this. I really want publications, and I really want to get this out there. This could be something interesting. I want other people to think about it. Maybe there is something going on. I want to publish it, but how should I handle this? So what you should do is you need to frame your results in the context of the multiple subgroup combinations you examine. So when you look at a paper, how many have seen papers where they see a result in some subgroup or some combination subgroup? Or how many people have seen that? Okay, so when you see that, what do you automatically think?
Fishing.
It's shady?
Fishing.
Okay, fishing. But if you're right, you think it may be fishing, so it's very easy to think you want to write it off. But what if it was real? What can you do as a writer in your paper to actually give some rationale? Maybe I publish this because I think this is something that should be examined. So, yes, I would look at it and think, wow, this is kind of a weird subgroup combination. They put four factors together. How did they come across this combination? Yeah, I'm not sure here. I might put the paper away and not start reading and not read the whole thing. But what you can do is if you frame the result in the context of the multiple subgroups examinations you did, you can give a little more credibility or a little more interpretability for the result for the reader. So basically what I'm saying is be honest. State what you did. If this subgroup result of being significant was the only one out of 50 different combinations I did, I should say that in the paper. I shouldn't put this forth as this was the only thing I looked at if I did 50 other things and it came about this one. If this was something that I had biological rationale for why I went into that subgroup, and I can defend why I put this together, then that should be stated. So you just need to give the correct context. It doesn't mean that you should report it, but you just need to give the full history of how you got there. Yes?
Is it worthwhile to sort of repower? Like, it's going to be a smaller sample and find some difference. It's, you know, so even if you find something, so it's probably very hard to do that or to believe that.
So my philosophy on that, so it wasn't what the study was designed for. So the study wasn't powered or designed to detect that. And sure, you could go through and see what the power was of this study. But at that point, does it matter? I mean, it doesn't matter how you use the power to be able to design the study to show that you have the ability to detect an effect. Going back post-mortem, kind of doing it, saying what the power was, isn't very informative because you kind of did this ad hoc anyhow. So I know that this wasn't, I instead of saying what the power was, what I would say was this was an exploratory analysis. The study was not designed to detect this. It's a subset, it's not a complete sample size. I wouldn't go back and actually compute what the power was for that test, because basically what I'm telling you is, was there a significant result? Okay, multiple tests, and this is a very, and I think all three of these I put in here are actual examples that I've come across as I've collaborated with people. So first example, you've got a clinical trial, you've got it running, and half the subjects are enrolled, and the data and outcomes are collected, and of course you haven't analyzed the data or looked at it yet by treatment group. You didn't plan to do any sort of interim analyses and look at the data. So this wasn't something pre-specified, this wasn't something you think you're going to do. But you realize that there's an abstract deadline in 2 weeks for a conference, and you think your study really would fit this conference, and you really want to give a talk and present results at it. But the abstract deadline is in 2 weeks, and your study's not going to be completed until right before the conference. So you think, well, maybe I can look at my data and do an analysis right now, and if I see something promising, I'll submit my abstract. And then I will, later on, when I finish the trial, I'll update that analysis and then I'll present it at the conference. And these are all very real situations, so if you've been in this situation, then you're going to find it's a very common thing. So this is a concern. Well, first off, should you do this? There are potential pitfalls. So what happens if you do this analysis, you see a great result, it's on partial, smaller subset of your data, you submit your abstract, you get ready to go to the conference, you reanalyze the data, update your poster, and you have a completely different result. Your results flip-flop. You saw an association, now when you get to the end of the study, it's completely flip-flop. Now you're stuck going to the conference with a completely different result. The problem here is that you have the multiple tests, you have the two tests, you look at the data while it's accumulating, but the big problem here is this wasn't something that was pre-planned and pre-specified before you started the study. You did an ad hoc look at the results, you didn't account for the multiple tests, you didn't account for the fact that you were looking at a smaller subset of your data, you had less evidence because your data was still accumulating. So I'm not saying here that interim analyses are bad. What I'm saying here is this is something that wasn't planned ahead of time, so you didn't have the appropriate mechanisms in place so that you could do an interim one. And we'll talk a little bit more about interim analyses, and Kurt's going to talk about adaptive trials later, and we'll have some more discussion on interim analyses. So a very real problem. Second example, and this is an exact example that I run into in my collaboration. So let's say you have a trial with a continuous outcome, and you're measuring a blood level, and you want to see if there's a difference in the outcome between some categorization of the good and the bad blood. And so you have to decide, how am I going to categorize this blood level? What is my cut point? I want to call it good and bad, but I need to decide how I'm going to categorize that. So you come up with the first definition, and you base it on the lab levels, the upper limits of normal, and so good is below the upper limits of normal, and bad is too high. You do the statistical test, and it's not significant. And you think, well, I've got this other biological definition for what's a meaningful cut point, and how I'm going to categorize this blood level for good and bad. And I do the second categorization on the same data, and I analyze it again, and it's not significant. but it was closer. Let's say it was 0.09 for p-value. And you think, wow, if I move that cut point just a little bit, I may get this magic less than 0.05 p-value. And you do it, and voila, I've got something significant. I'm very excited I've got a significant p-value. But the question is, do you report that difference using the third categorization and saying that was your cut point for looking for, looking at the association between the two? And of course, I'm going to say no. And I had this exact situation with a collaborator once. And I understand the temptation, and I understand the temptation to want to have a significant result. And so what I said was, for this third one, yes, I will do the analyses, but I will only do the analyses for this third cut point if you also report the other two at the same time in your results section. And needless to say, at that case, the clinician decided, well, no, let's not do this third test. Because it shows that this was clearly a result that could be a result of multiple testing. There's not a lot of credibility to it. It would not go over well when being your resident. Okay, a third one. You've got this big double-blind randomized clinical trial takes 3 years to enroll. And you got the two arms, you've got intervention control, and the outcome is measured at 3 months. So it's going to take 3 years to enroll, and then you've got an extra 3 months of follow-up. So you've got a long time frame here that you're actually enrolling the trial. And you think, wow, 3 years is a long time. I really want to look. I want to analyze the data. I want to look at unblinded analyses, maybe to see if early on, maybe I already know that one treatment is better than the other. And we talked about this a little bit. This was discussed a little bit yesterday in the context of DSMBs. So you really want to look and say, I don't want to have to wait 3 years. Maybe I know at 2 years that this drug is better, and I don't want to wait for the whole thing to continue. Is this a bad thing? No, this isn't bad, but you have to handle ahead of time these multiple interim analyses, these multiple tests. If you put interim analyses in your trial where you're going to look early for possibility of stopping early and declaring success, there are multiple considerations you need to make. Because in interim monitoring, the probability of attaining a significant result at 0.05 significance level with a certain number of looks, the more looks you make, there's a higher probability of making a type 1 error. And this has been known for a long time. This is from a paper way back in the 1969 Journal of the West Statistical Society. It's kind of a common example of the more intervals you do, the more chance you have of making a type 1 error. So this needs to be very carefully done. The other thing that needs to be considered is that earlier interim analyses in your study is still accruing throughout this 3 years, the early interim analyses may be different from the later interim analyses. We talked about that simple example in our abstract. But also, these earlier interim analyses are based upon less evidence. You have fewer subjects enrolled. So in that situation, you may want stronger evidence of a success because you have less evidence overall as far as the subject control study. So how would you handle these interim analyses and resulting decisions? There are acceptable methods. There are lots of methods out there. There are standard methods that have been used for several years. There are new methods being developed every day with the adaptive designs and to tailor the design specifically to your question, where you can use these interim analyses in your trial. However, there's a process to go about it to have a credibly well-designed trial. And it requires a lot of pre-planning, but that's a good thing. The more I know about my trial before I start from a design standpoint, as far as how it's going to perform, what it's going to do, how in certain scenarios of what I think the difference may be between the treatment and the control, how it's going to go about selecting that. Knowing that ahead of time and making sure that meets my goals and answers my study questions is a good thing. So the pre-planning up front is very, very valuable because as you can imagine, once the study gets going, there's limited ability to adjust things on the fly. You want to have thought about these possible issues ahead of time and have them built into the design. And then as I just said, if you're going to use some sort of stopping early for possible early success, you're going to have less evidence than you plan for your full sample size. You have fewer subjects, so you may want a higher level of evidence to be sure that if you stop at that point, you know, you've shown overwhelmingly that you've shown that there is an effect here, and that it would hold through if you had continued through to the end of your trial. So those are kind of some of the thought process going on. So, when you do these types, when you have larger trials, and you know, interim analyses are perfectly applicable in phase two trials. In fact, that's also very good in phase two trials with having adaptive design and making decisions to go along. But you need to think about ahead of time, and they you need to think about when these interim analyses are going to occur. Am I going to do about four? Am I going to do five? Am I going to do these weekly? Am I going to do these monthly? When do they start? Do I wait for a certain number of subjects to enroll before I start looking? And this is a very important question, because often when you start doing a trial, you need to have a certain number of subjects to look at safety. So you would want to start looking early with the potential of maybe stopping your study before you had enough subjects to have kind of a safety database in place. So thinking about when these books will start, you need to think about ahead of time what the decisions are going to be made. You can't just do an analysis of unblinded data while the trial is ongoing, look at the data, and then decide what to do based on what you see. You need to think ahead of time what's going to happen and pre-specify this. How are you going to account for the multiple interim analyses? Who is going to perform these interim analyses? You as the clinician running the study are very, very involved with the study. You may be treating the patients, you may be enrolling the patients. If you start looking at unblinded data while study is ongoing and then continue going to trial, you're going to have an inherent bias because you know what's going on, and it may affect intentionally or unintentionally how you treat subjects later just because you know what's going on. If it was a blind, and this is a situation where I'm assuming you're blinded in the study, so you would not be the one to perform these analyses. And then there are many other logistical considerations as far as how are you going to do this, how's the data coming in, who's going to do this, who's going to make the decisions, how it's going to communicate. There's lots of pieces that need to go in place. This isn't a bad thing. It just needs to have thought done up front. But the more pre-planning you have, the better trial you're going to have in the end. And the credibility is important. And this is essential to have for any sort of trial that has interim analysis while you go along.
So if you have, if you plan to do an interim analysis, is there anything you can do about that?
Yes. There are several, statistically, there are several things you can do to account for it. Let's take a very standard, it's called a group sequential design. You may have heard about O'Brien-Fleming boundaries. How many have heard of that? Okay, great. So so O'Brien-Fleming boundary is actually a boundary that's put in place that decides at each time point when you make your interim look. And I should say O'Brien-Fleming there's many different boundaries. There's alpha spending rules, there's all sorts of ways to look at these things. But what it is while the trial's ongoing and when you're making your looks, there are thresholds for when you would decide to stop early, and it's usually much, much lower p-values because you need a higher level of evidence at these earlier time points to say that something is going on. And statistically, mathematically, these have been worked out to control the type 1 error. So by doing X number of looks, here's your criteria as far as if it was a frequency test, as far as what you might compare the p-value to decide whether or not you would stop early. It's going to require, like I said, a higher level of evidence, and then your final test at the end, if you would have kept going, is not going to be a p-value less than 0.5. It's going to be a p-value lower than something, less than something lower than 0.5, to have accounted for the multiple tests. But then in that case, you have to remember that you only get to that final test if you kept going. So, and then hugely important here, and I hope you started hearing this with the statisticians you work with, or you will hear it later today, trial simulation is a very, very good thing. Kurt's going to discuss it later, and it's very important with these type of designs, not only for the statisticians to understand how they perform, but for you to understand how they perform, because by simulating the trial, you can take these different scenarios and say, okay, here's a real-life scenario of a difference between A and B. Let's actually simulate an actual trial and look at the decisions that would be made. And then you can look at it and understand, oh, that would stop in this scenario, or maybe that wouldn't stop, or this is the adaptation that would be made, or this is what would happen. And then you can look at it and see how comfortable you feel with that and see the future study goals. Okay, here's another example. So you have a clinical trial for traumatic brain injury, and it's examining an experimental treatment versus the standard of care. So we've got another multiplicity example here. And I'll get to why. You have this question that you're not sure how fast, how soon after the injury, the treatment needs to be administered. And based upon the background and the mechanism of the treatment, you think, I think within 2 hours it's going to be better. And these, this is totally made up by me, so if you don't like the hour breakdown, I just made it up. So I apologize. It's clearly not realistic. But you think within 2 hours may be better. But, you know, up to 12 hours, 2 to 12 hours, that may also work. So I'm interested in this trial of enrolling, allowing people to enroll in the trial within both these time frames. And I don't just automatically want to knock out those after 2 hours, but I really want to focus on those within 2 hours because I think that's really how it's going to work. And so you want to compare the active treatment to the standard of care within both of these populations because that's your question. Does it work in both of these? And I've thought about my sample size considerations. I've thought about the type 1 error rate I want to have. And I decided I think I want my my alpha level to be 5%. But then I also have to think, okay, I have two tests. I have my two groups here. So I have two shots on goal, so I have an increased chance of making this type 1 error. And my next question is, as I'm thinking through this as an investigator, do I need to adjust the results? Well, I'm going to give you an example here of an adjustment method. I'm not advocating for this adjustment. I've probably heard of Bonferroni adjustment. I figured you have. So if you haven't, the Bonferroni adjustment actually takes the alpha level and adjusts by the number of tests, divides by the number of tests. So here I have two tests. So I take the 5%, divide by 2. My new significance level for each of the tests is 0.025. If I saw a p-value less than 0.025, I would say there's a significant result. Now, Bonferroni is a pretty strict adjustment by taking and cutting it all the way in half. First off, like I said, this isn't the only method. There are lots of methods out there. And by doing this, I've adjusted down to a threshold of 0.025. But now because my alpha is lower, your power now is going to be lower. You probably saw that yesterday when you did some of your examples in the sample size exercise, how looking at different thresholds affects the power in the study. And therefore, because my power is lower, I want my power to be back up to this adequate level that I've decided on ahead of time. So now I need to enroll more subjects. So my result of having two tests, getting the desire, adjusting for the multiplicities, having the desire by power one, has now resulted in a larger trial. But let's step back. We didn't think about this at all in the context of the question. All we thought was we had two tests, and we thought, okay, this is a multiplicity issue, which is good. And we did this very harsh adjustment. Thinking back and with our two groups, would you think that giving the intervention quicker would yield better results? So if the intervention did not work in the less than 2 hours, would you think that it would work in the 2 to 12 hours? That probably doesn't fit the mechanism here, because I'm thinking from everything I know, quicker is better. I've got to get this to the subject. So based upon that, I may want to do a different type of method to adjust for the multiplicities. So maybe I don't have to do this harsh Bonferroni adjustment. And maybe there's a different way I can do this. And of course there is, that's why I put it up here. So let's say you start and you pre-specify this. And you start and I say I'm going to test the active treatment versus control, and I'm going to start in the 0 to 2 hours group, because this is my main group of interest. And if it's significant at the 5% level, then and only then is it significant, am I going to go forward and actually test in the 2 to 12 hours. If it wasn't significant in the 0 to 2, I'm not even going to test it over. I pre-specified this in the protocol, and therefore it preserved the power for the comparison in the 0 to 2 hour group, because I didn't have to adjust my alpha level, therefore I didn't lose power, therefore I didn't have to enroll more subjects. And it can be shown that using this gatekeeping method preserves the type 1 error. So this is just kind of a high-level overview of there are lots of methods for accounting for the multiple comparison. But the key point is it always ties back to your research question. And the statisticians you work with, you know, will have background in various ways to control for multiplicities. But again, the key point here, think back in terms of your research question. So doing a Bonferroni here would have been perfectly valid. But it would have made things more difficult to probably get end up in a large trial. Okay, so what's the strategy for how to handle multiplicity? So, and one of the big messages of the paper and one of the big messages that you will hear from talking to statisticians is very complicated. There's not a hard and fast rule. Not everyone agrees on how this should be handled or a specific technique that should be used, or if you even need to account for multiplicities. Some philosophy out there, and you'll see a quote in the paper says, you know, how can you penalize yourself for looking at many different questions when there's all this data out there in the world? I mean, it's just not a hard and fast rule. But what we would like you to do is actually be aware of this and be able to have a strategy for moving forward so that you can state when and if it could be a concern, so you can have credibility for your results to the reader and be very, very confident in resulting with the goal of your usable research. So we talk about study questions, the need for a lot about your study question, and what you should shoot for selecting a primary aim and a primary outcome. It's nicer if you have one, you may have two, but if you can select that one big take-home question, and design your trial around that, worry about the controlling multiplicities around that, and have that be the main focus of your study, you can help control for the multiplicities and the risk of having a false positive. You can still have secondary exploratory analysis. This isn't saying not to look at many things and investigate many things, but they may not have the same level of evidence required as that main goal of your study. So if you can actually split your goals up and sort the priority of your goals, that's going to be helpful. Pre-specification is huge. So you want to define these primary and secondary analyses in the protocol. And so it's all laid out ahead of time before you look at the data. The data did not lead you towards what is your primary goal and your and which ones are secondary exploratory. Pre-specified ahead of time. And then you need to describe before you start looking at the data how you're going to handle the multiple tests if you do have a multiplicity issue. And if you don't, you need to defend why no adjustments will be made and be very clear about it. You don't just want to throw multiple tests out there and not even address it. When you report the results, be very clear on how you arrived at the results. If it was the primary analysis, state it. If it wasn't, and it was an exploratory multiple subgroup analysis, be very clear. How many subgroups did you examine? That example I gave before, I found 1 out of 50. I should say I looked at 50 different subgroups. I should say why I looked at 50 different subgroups. I'm probably not going to get actually fishing or probably not going to, I'm not going to want to say that, but that really tells provides the credibility for the results so that the readers can evaluate it. And then you also should state whether these subgroups were predefined. You may have very valid subgroups in your study that you want to look at. You could design the study to have power in that specific subgroup, it's a subgroup of interest, put that in the protocol ahead of time. It's pre-specified and it's in there before you look at the data and it's not data-driven, it'll have a lot more credibility and that may lead to actual interest in conducting follow-up studies and that confirm the results. So interpret it correctly and do not overstate. If something is exploratory and there could be a risk of a chance alone, a false positive, state it. It's very common in protocols for secondary exploratory analyses. I may not just adjust for multiple states because, and I may say no adjustments will be made for these multiple tests, but results will be interpreted due to caution. Will be interpreted with caution due to the fact that results could be significant due to chance alone. And I state that out right front. I'm very clear these are exploratory, I'm learning. There's going to be a follow-up study to investigate it, potential follow-up study, I state that. There are statistical adjustment methods. So in fields where multiplicity, like looking at imaging studies that we were just talking about, where there are multiple regions of the brain, or you're looking at different genetic studies where you have many, many genes. There are methods and they should be used and you should state them and you should plan them ahead of time. It's just inherent nature of the question being asked. Usually when you have multiplicity that requires more evidence, you need a higher probability that the result is real. Because the main story here is you want to limit this probability that the result can be due to chance alone. Again, limiting the chance that it's a false positive. However, with these adjustments, you need to be aware that there are consequences with any sort of adjustment to multiplicities. You may lose power in the study, and it may result in increased sample size in the end. So you need to kind of balance all these things together as far as how many tests I want to do, what kind of adjustments I have to do, what that will affect my other study beyond operating characteristics. So in summary, multiplicity is very, very complicated. There's not a hard and fast way that you should go forward. I can't give you a specific rule of this is how you need to handle it. But I can say what you should do is you should prepare your protocol in advance, and you should specify your primary aids. If you can take care of these in the design part, that's a winner right there. In publication and summary, to be very clear what was found through pre-specified analyses and what wasn't. You also need to keep track of everything you analyze. So when you start and you get all this data, don't start and just start performing all the statistical tests. Start descriptive. Start looking at summaries. What are my mean? What is my mean? What's my variability? What's the range of the data? Do lots of plots if you have follow-up data over time. What does this look like? Start descriptive. Really get a good feel of what's going. You don't have to do statistical tests right away. You can do lots of pictures to understand what's going on before diving in and just doing a bunch of statistical tests. And then you've got this plan ahead of time for how you analyze the results. And you should keep track of anything you analyze, especially once you start getting exploratory. When it's necessary, adjust. But again, it's better if you can focus during the design phase to have techniques in place to handle and account for the multiplicity. And adjust statistically at the end because you get a whole bunch of tests. And the big thing is you want your results to be reproducible. Chances are you're going to have a follow-up study that's going to confirm the results. So if you do a phase two and you're bringing it to phase three, you're sure hoping that that result is still going to hold because you're going to put this effort in this larger trial to have the confirmatory evidence. So you want to have done well to select something like a good chance of having that confirmation or that reproducible result. Or if someone goes out and conducts your study, you definitely want them to obtain a similar result, not have something completely different. And if you have results from an exploratory analysis and you have a confirmatory study or a second study plan, state that in the paper. State that these are exploratory, state that there's a plan. If you're saying that you're willing to conduct another study to confirm these results, the reader may, this can have more credibility in the results because there's probably going to be a rationale for why you think this is real, possible moving forward. Consider your results, again, in the context of your question. It's not just the p-values and the tests you did. You had a prospective biologic rationale. Does it fit the rationale? Now, again, we can usually rationalize anything. I could probably come up for a rationale for that men greater than 50 with a medical history X population I looked at. So that can be a slippery one because it's very easy to rationalize things after the fact. But if there is a realistic biological rationale, put it in there. And if there's previous published studies, cite those and state why you think this is. This can be based upon biological rationale. It may not just be due to chance alone, the fact that it's multiple tests. And one of the other big things, if there are multiple publications that are going to come out, lots of big trials may have 6 or 7 publications coming out. And I may be a researcher going into PubMed looking for some information, and my question may pick and hit on one of those studies. And I may not realize that there were 7 other papers that came out, 7 other analyses. So if your publication is a part of a multiple publication process, it's helpful in that publication to be very clear that there were 6 other analyses that were also done and published so that the reader could have the full context of this result in what was going on and know that this wasn't the primary and that there were multiple other things going on and be very clear whether it was pre-specified or not. So I think that's a big one too that's not always very clear. And you may not hit unless you know the initial project really well. And based upon that, we've got time for more questions. I hope you have more questions. I hope it's not clear as mud, but hopefully this gave you some strategies for handling multiplicities and for thinking about it ahead of time, because you're going to run into it. It's very common, you're going to run into it, and just mainly thinking about it and planning ahead and knowing that this potential problem exists is halfway out.
Hearing about Bayesian perspective and moving away from the p-values, so would that be an option to kind of account for multiplicity, or what scenario would that work?
So by doing a Bayesian, it doesn't remove the risk of multiplicities. Each paradigm has its own ability to account for a type 1 error rate, a false positive, and it's all based on probabilities as well. So just doing something patient is helpful, but there are methods in each. But the techniques are the strategy here of planning ahead and pre-specifying that would apply to both. So, but there are the statistical methods, there are ways in both of them to account for false positive, and it's all based on the level of evidence, the probability that that you're determining at the end. But it's not by going Bayesian, it doesn't just account for it. Bayesian is a great way to go and a great way to think. But it's not just doing that, doesn't remove the problem, the potential.
I guess it's similar to having multiple treatment groups, but in a scenario where you actually just have one treatment group, but you're looking at multiple outcomes,
yes.
You know, with the same sort of predictor, but different sort of outcomes. It's the same concept, it's exploratory, it's the primary question, but in exploratory analysis, these are things you need to just justify saving or just sort of fishing that we're exploring, or do you need to actually go in? Is there a correction piece there, or what do you think?
So I'm going to use my usual answer as a statistician, which Erica stole from me, and say it depends. but what you would do, so multiple outcomes, sure, you're definitely going to have multiple outcomes. And in the secondary phase, there are you can do techniques afterwards to account for your multiple tests. You can rationalize and say, okay, I'm not adjusting because these are exploratory, and I'm going to be following up with a confirmatory study. I can provide biologic rationale, or maybe I'm not adjusting. This is why I'm looking for these outcomes. There are methods that can be pre-specified in the protocol. Sometimes there's a hierarchical method where you go through the secondary outcomes in a sequence. And so we kind of talked about our sequential gatekeeping thing, but there are other ways to do that through secondary outcomes as far as what the significance level is, as far as where the sequence, the outcomes are, and that's because it's going to the results. And I guess you just have to decide up front on the risk you're willing to take in those analyses for having a false positive, what your plans are next, and think about that all ahead of time. So you can adjust. If you don't, you just need to be very clear why you didn't. And have that appropriate caution statement with you.
So in the trials that we do at my institution, we may be looking at a bunch of, let's say, outcome measures, and we may say, you know what, it's so easy to give this scale, it takes 5 minutes, let's add it on as a, you know, as a secondary outcome. And, you know, at the end of the day, you might end up with, like, 3 or 4 extra secondary outcomes you haven't thought of. Now, based on what you've been talking about, will this, you know, my guess is that this probably would be, for us to get meaningful results, we might end up having to increase our, you know, our sample size, and certainly I would guess there it would affect type 1 error, but could you comment about kind of the dangers or pitfalls of doing this? I would imagine this is not something that is, this is could negatively impact, you know, the statistics at the end of the study.
So, and so you're saying, okay, so you have, I understand that subjects are coming in, there's multiple pieces of information you want to get, multiple things you want to look at. That's all fine. It can be in the secondary exploratory phase. You should be very clear what's the primary aim and design of the study to be able to answer that question. You need to understand with these additional outcomes that are looked at, I may not be able to, the study wasn't designed to really look at whether there was a difference between treatments with some of these outcomes from these surveys, and understand that going in, and understand that these really are exploratory. If you do, I wouldn't want to do 1,000 of these, because then obviously the more I've done, there's a much, much higher chance that some are going to be using anything else. So chance alone. But what I would do in that situation is I would collect the information. I may report the results descriptively. I would summarize them and be very forthcoming that they are completely exploratory. I'd be very clear how many of them there were. And I would discuss that. Hopefully there'll be intention if you did find something there. Follow-up study to confirm it, and be very clear that this could just be due to chance alone. So putting all those caveats in there, you can do an adjustment, But if you do an adjustment, like you said, where you adjust the alpha level and maybe have a higher threshold for significance because of the multiple tests, it's going to lower your power even further. But your study wasn't designed to answer those questions, so there really are secondary and exploratory. So it's a fine line of whether or not you have to adjust.
There are any more questions and thanks, Michelle. It was great.